Dean of the College of Public Policy, and we are once again very honored to team with the League of Women Voters to host one of our forums. This is a District 5 City Council Forum. We are District 5, and we're really happy to do this tonight and have all of you here. This morning, we had this room filled with about 150 first graders. So if y'all start squirming in your seats or anything, we will understand. But we had a lot of fun with them today. This event tonight is also co-sponsored by two student organizations. So I wanted to let Mercedes introduce herself and tell you just a little bit about those two student organizations.
Hi everyone, I am Mercedes Dawes. I'm the president of the Public Administration Student Organization. And what we do events like networking events, volunteer events throughout the community. Like we did an event at Haven for Hope, and we did an event at Animal Care Shelter. We made blankets for puppies and kittens. And so we really try to engage the community and have the students learn more about what careers they might want to do. Recently we had an event called Conversation Fighters. We had guest speakers come and share their experience with the students, with what they could do for a career. And then we also went to City Hall last week, which was really fun. Alpha Phi Sigma also sponsored this event, but they're not here. They are the criminal justice on site. You do the downtown campus. So, thank you for coming today.
Alpha Phi Sigma students are off studying somewhere or in their classes right now. So it is now my honor to introduce your moderator, the wonderful Phyllis Ingram of the amazing and historic League of Women Voters. So thank you again for coming.
I would like to thank Dr. Romero and the student organizations who are partnering with us this evening. They are always wonderful partners for us. We try and get in at least one candidate forum every election here at UTSA. Thank you for being here this evening. I apologize. But since we're here, let's please all silence any electronic devices. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization that encourages the informed and active participation in government. Candidate forums are one of the ways that we help voters get informed. We also produce a voter guide prior to each election. The voter guide candidate information is available right now on vote411.org. You may have seen these cards outside. There's a voting app called the Voting App, and it has not only the League of Women Voters candidate information, but also the MoveSA candidate information. And the printed voter guides will be available the week of April 17th. Excuse me. Early voting begins on April 24th and ends May 2nd. And election day is May 6th. There are cards available to write out a question for the candidates. Please make them general, as all candidates will be answering the same question. If you have a question on a card, hold it up and one of the students will pick it up. If you want to write a question on a card and you don't have a card, raise your hand and someone will bring you a card and a pen. Excuse me. Chris Forbrick from the League of Women Voters will be sorting the questions. And we sort questions not to eliminate questions, but to consolidate questions with a similar or same topic. We want to give the candidates a chance to answer as many questions as possible this evening. Candidates have agreed to refrain from directing questions or remarks to each other. All questions will come from the moderator. The candidates will have 2 minutes for opening statement, then we'll rotate questions so that each candidate will have an opportunity to answer first and last. At the conclusion of the questioning, each candidate will have 1 minute for a closing statement. I would like to acknowledge some people here in the audience this evening. Former Councilwoman Patty Radel. Mayoral candidates Antonio Diaz and Rhett Smith. Maria and Chris, here in the front row, will be the timers for the forum. Maria will hold up a yellow card. You want to show them what it looks like, Maria? That has 20, when you have 20 seconds remaining. And then when she holds up the red card, please stop so that we can get as many questions in as possible. So with that, let me introduce to you the candidates, starting on my immediate left, Shirley Gonzales. Cynthia Cavazos. David Yañez. Richard Montez. Daniel Lopez. And Dolores Sotomayor. So we will begin with Shirley Gonzales with your 2-minute opening statement.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming today. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for hosting us this evening, and also to UTSA for letting us use your space. I am Shirley Gonzales. I'm the councilwoman for District 5. I'm seeking re-election for my third term on office, respectfully asking for your vote. I promised three things when I ran for re-election: that I would improve the lighting in the area, that I would work with public safety to make our neighborhood safer, and that I would work with animal care services in particular. That was one of the big things that we were working on. Since then, we've been able to tackle those by adding lighting, by increasing the amount of officers in our district, and increasing the one officer of animal care services to the district. I look forward to serving you all in the next few years by working with our bond committee to make sure that the money that you all support for the bond is used effectively and appropriately. I look forward to continuing to work on public safety, which is a big issue in this area. One of my commitments when I came on council was to continue to work on this specific area around Haven for Hope and the amount of vagrants in the area. And as a result, we've been able to get three additional bike patrol officers for the area. And we continue to work with our 6 law enforcement officers that are right here in this area to make sure that our community remains safe. I am also looking forward to continuing the basic work that needs to be done in this area, especially regarding sidewalks, street infrastructure, parks, and lighting, the things that you all have told me that you're most concerned about. But I also look forward to working with the small business community, especially the entrepreneurial community, and also the longstanding businesses in the community. District 5 is one of the oldest parts of San Antonio. We have businesses here that have been here for 50 years and longer. So I look forward to working with the business community to make sure that we can support small businesses in the area. Thank you very much.
Ms. Cavazos, 2-minute opening statement.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Cynthia T. Cavazos. I'm a District 5, City of San Antonio, district candidate. The reason why we are all here today is to figure out to see exactly who it is that we want to vote for and who it is that we want to represent our city, much less our district. District 5, as y'all do know, is a beautiful district. It runs from one part of town to the other. We have so many things within our district that needs to be changed, and you as the constituent body can make that change. You just have to open your mouths, you have to use that right hand or that left hand, and you know who it is you want to vote for, and everybody will be able to get things done properly. And this is basically one of the reasons why I decided to run for office. There is too many issues in the city of San Antonio within the district, as well as out of the district, that we need to change.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez.
Hello, everyone. My name is David Yañez. I'm an immigration attorney. My area of interest has always been economics and cultural awareness of a place. What got me involved in running for this office is very important, because the city of San Antonio is on its way to going someplace, and I want to help it get there. But I think we're also veering off, because we have a light of this $850 million bond, and not all the subject areas are being attended to properly. What I feel is it's, you know, government of the people, by the people, and for the people. But we must also examine the economic and cultural awareness of places within the city. I think we're losing some of them. You know, it's like, for instance, one of the last things that occurred was, you know, the Malt House. It's a cultural icon, families, neighbors, a place of community where people come together and have fun and congregate. And now it's, you know, being converted towards business, most likely a 7-Eleven. If we lose these cultural icons in our city, then what are we? You know, we're going to be moving towards profiteering rather than cultural and dynamic awareness of what created the city. That's what my concern is. I studied economic development at the University of Pennsylvania. I have a master's degree in city planning and also my law degree, focusing on federal law, which is now immigration. I worked at Catholic Charities. I dealt with clients at the Battered Women and Children's Shelter because everyone needs advocacy. But in part of my work, I worked for Senator Vandepute's office for almost 5 years, and one of her subject areas was economic and cultural awareness. So we gave a suggestion, I did the research, and we created the Texas Treasurer Business Award, Senate Bill 920. What's important about that, it recognizes and distinguishes other businesses in the area because they haven't been recognized like they should be at the state level, and also you recognize the whole state. One of the bigger ones was the Buckhorn Saloon, so I'm always proud of that one. But those ideas is what I wish to bring to San Antonio and for District 5.
Thank you. Mr. Montez?
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. How are you all? Thank you for being here, and thank you to UTSA and the League of Women Voters and the School of Public Policy for hosting us here this evening. Again, my name is Richard Montez, and I'm here respectfully asking for your support in this coming election. The message behind our campaign has always been progress for every generation. And having grown up in this community as a graduate of Lanier High School and St. Mary's University, I've come to intimately understand the issues and the obstacles that face our members of our community day in and day out. And we want to begin to have a broader conversation about progress. You know, every generation and every council person that comes through District 5 will see a bond project, they'll see a bond program, they'll have the opportunity to allocate funds to infrastructure. And that's almost sort of the traditional thing that has happened council person after council person. But I believe that what's been lacking in this conversation about broader progress is beginning to pinpoint some of the larger issues that we face in our neighborhood. Multi-generational poverty, the lack of dignified housing in our community, the impending threat of gentrification on some of our oldest communities in San Antonio, particularly in District 5. And in order to begin to address some of those issues, I think first we need to start having the conversation about them. That conversation has been missing for far too long. But I also believe that if we are going to achieve progress, and that progress looks like the way that the community wants it to, at the very foundation, what we need to do is begin listening to people and gathering people's input. So I've begun to, in this campaign, begun to propose a number of measures to start to address some of these issues. First and foremost, creating some advisory boards that will have the ear and the attention of the city council person, giving our youth our opportunity to participate in those advisory boards, meet with me as a council person on a monthly basis, and give me their ideas and their input on what they want to see in their community. We spend a whole lot of time asking our kids what they should want, and not enough time asking them what they do want. I appreciate your time here, and I ask for your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez?
Hello, everyone. I'm Daniel Lopez, and I'm running for City Council District 5. Can everybody hear me? Thank you. The reason why I'm running is because I was born in District 5, and I grew up in District 5, and I went to school on District 5 in a private school known as Christian Academy of San Antonio. It used to be called the Old Centeno. That's what a lot of people know it as, but it's in the district, very popular historic area. But I'm running because I see that a change needs to be made. I see that someone needs to be out there and make that change. And I want to step up and speak my voice as an American citizen and as an American right to yell and say there is a problem and then fix it. I want to be your voice in District 5, and I want to help fix things. My father used to tell me when I was younger that he used to come to me and say, son, I want you to always know this. If I can do it, you can do it. And that's something that always stayed with me, because I've seen my parents struggle through a lot. We weren't the most fortunate family, and we were blessed to have each other. And if he can do it, if I saw him struggle through it, then I can struggle through some stuff and get stuff done. So I wanna struggle and fight for the people of District 5 to be their voice, and I wanna bring change in our transportation system. I want to help the homeless people to eliminate homelessness, because I know it is a big issue that nobody in city council wants to really touch on. I don't know if people are afraid to go speak to them or what, but I want to go speak to them as a person, as their human right. And I want to change infrastructure, just so we don't always have to see construction each cycle when someone new in city council comes. So please vote for me, and I'm respectfully asking for your vote. April 24th, if you want to beat the Lions, but May 6th is very crucial. So thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Sotomayor.
Good evening. I'm Dolores Sotomayor. I'm a proud mother of six and a very great, a big proud grandmother of eight. I've lived most of my life in San Antonio. I went to school here and I studied a lot here. And I've lived in District 5 for about a total of 6 years. And I see the problem of our generation is letting our parents, our grandparents' generation fade away. And it doesn't happen just in one day. It's a fade away station. And I want to help that. I want for this generation to help their parents, whatever business they had or whatever they had going on here, for it to continue. It needs to keep going, and we need to fight crime. Right now, the crime, especially in District 5 on the west side, it's really bad. It's really, really bad. It's gotten out of hand. And if we don't grab it and take control over it right now, it's just, we're not going to have anything left. People are getting murdered left and right. And that's just not right. We need to protect each other. We need to be a voice for each other. And for the ones that are afraid, for the little ancianitos that don't want to come outside and do their garden anymore, we need to be their voice to say, hey, you know what? We're here for you, and you can do your garden. You can do the things that you love to do. And I want to be there to help them and to let them come back out and let our kids be outside and play and not worry that someone's going to harm them, because that's going on way too much in our homes, in our schools. And I just want to be the voice to help for the ones that won't speak. And I respectfully ask for your vote on May 6th or April 24th. Be blessed.
Thank you. We're going to start the questioning with Ms. Cavazos. You have 1 minute for your answer. If elected, what are one or two concrete steps you would take to increase and improve transparency in city government?
That's an excellent question.
I wish I could say it was mine, but.
very good question. I'm going to say that if elected, my first concrete steps or what it is that I'm going to do to change the city of San Antonio would be to balance the budget. You know, the budget, we have so many dollars, approximately $200 something billion that go towards the city budget. How those dollars are spent, I'm not going to tell you that I know, because I don't, except for the budget that they have instilled within the city. Within each district in the city of San Antonio, each district is needing something, and they're needing something important, whether it be social services, whether it be more more criminal justice, whether it be more cops, whether it be more places of employment. But that would be the main thing that I would do, is go in and re-audit the budget.
Thank you. Mr. Yanis?
Yes, sir. What I believe for transparency is, first step is examining neighborhood associations. That's our first level of government. I believe once the neighborhood associations are established, because not all areas have it in the district, but I would like to go for a 100% complete coverage of the entire District 5 that has advocacy. There has to be some neighbors who haven't been reached out to, and let them know that they want to be included. Well, we'll create a neighborhood association. If not, but at least know who those active neighbors are. Many constituents always call and they wish to get information. I'm familiar with that, working for my previous jobs. People want to know, hey, I heard this, the city's working on this project, can you get more details? Well, it's up to the council person to say, sure, let me get that information, we'll mail it to you, or you can come to the office and we'll review it together. Everyone wants a chance to have a better understanding. Everyone's level is not the same, but we must reach out to them, because As part of government, we're supposed to be there for them. And when the client is ready, or I'm sorry, the constituent is ready, they wish to come in, I'm an attorney, I get clients. When the constituent comes in, they want to understand, and we have to be there for them to explain it at the level they understand so they can make the best decision. Thank you.
Mr. Montez?
Yes, thank you for this question. I think it's important, and you heard me allude to this in my opening. I think at the very basis of community involvement is the idea that we should invite people to the table. And so I've created a number of concrete plans to be able to begin to start that process. One is the creation of a citizens advisory board to the council person. This advisory board will be made up of individuals from across District 5, nonprofit organizations, the folks who participate regularly in the community, but also begin to invite new faces and new voices. I'd love to see more people involved in our community that are from places like the Alasana Apache courts, people from the Casianos, people from the Lincoln courts. Invite them to be part of the conversation, even if you don't think that they're part of that big voter demographic. Still, they should have a voice. And so that's just one concrete idea. I also, as I mentioned before, want to create youth advisory boards so that they can come to the table and have a voice in the decisions we make as well.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez?
Thank you for the question. Hello? Okay. I would like to hold, as a first thing, I would like to hold City Council accountable for the things that are discussed in City Council about each district and about, in particular, District 5. And I would like to ask questions in City Council to see where the money's going and where and how it's going to benefit the people, and then have a translation to the people to where they would understand no matter what the cause or case is. I would like to reach out to each person. Each person learns a different way. Some people are more hands-on. Some people like to listen. Some people are just different ways. So we need to find the way to which we can get out to most people and just focus on our community and reach out to see what really is going on in the City Council. And people that are not even voters, we should get them involved and explain how voting is important and how you should have a voice in voting. So I would like to do that as well.
Thank you. Ms. Sotomayor?
I would like to give more funding to the neighborhood associations because they're the ones that live in the area. They know what's going on. They actually know. They don't have to go, you know, asking anybody else. They know because usually it's right down the street or somewhere in the area. I would like them to have more control and for the citizens to know and understand where the money is going, what is happening with it. Not just, okay, here's this and no explanation. That's not right. If we're all together, then we should know where everything's going. Be accountable for everything that's going on. And I would like to also have a committee to where it's the people that live in District 5 that have meetings and more than one national night out so that the community can come together and share their experiences or share how we can work together.
Thank you. Ms. Gonzales?
I think the best way to improve transparency on city government is to not have so many individual committees. So I, as a council member, sit on about 6 different committees. That means throughout the month, I'm attending a meeting multiple times a week. And many of the times, decisions are made in committee, and then they're put on the council agenda in a session on consent, and there's never a discussion about it. And during A session, and sometimes during B session, we only discuss one or two items. And sometimes our council meetings, if you notice, they can be as short as 30 minutes at a session. When there's actually a lot of discussion that happened in the committee meetings or at B session meetings, but the only ones that are really made public are the A session and the B session. So I believe that having fewer committee meetings and also having the opportunity for citizens to be heard during our committee meetings would be one way we can increase the transparency. All these meetings are open to the public. Anybody can come and sit in our committee meetings, but the fact that we don't discuss them in an A session or B
Thank
session removes some transparency from the process.
Thank you. We're going to begin this question with Mr. Yañez. What will you do to combat child abuse and neglect in District 5?
That's a tough question. One thing I would say, sometimes I believe in dealing with the clients or meeting a battered woman shelter at the Family Justice Center, somehow a lot of the issues are always economic related. The jobs, people are not working, and they get frustrated, and there's not enough money. It's like one time one of the clients had come in, and she was injured because the fellow, her spouse, had come home at 10:30 at night, and he wanted dinner. And, you know, she had put in a whole day herself, and then they got into a hassle, and then he hit her, and then she had a wound shoulder. He's, you know, and he was beginning to work again. And part of it is it's jobs. I think what we can do is, that, so there's a term called ban the box or fair chance hiring. That's for persons who have some criminal background that they can at least make the applications without being excluded. I think we should start from the bottom up and make sure that these folks have jobs, otherwise we're gonna have to be helping them out. And somehow that connection is because everyone has families and children, but we gotta give them some guidance and support so that way they don't take their frustrations out on their families. That's my approach, thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Montez.
Thank you. You know, I think child abuse is part of a bigger issue that's got some underlying cyclical challenges, in particularly in communities like ours where people live in poverty. And many of these instances of child abuse do come out of frustration. But I think that if we begin to address some of these underlying issues that we have in District 5, then we begin to address child abuse in general. You know, folks that don't have access to resources like adequate education, adequate parenting classes, in a community that has a very high rate of teen pregnancy, it's where you see these higher instances of child abuse. And I think if we're going to begin to address some of these concerns, then, as I mentioned earlier, we need to start having a broader conversation about the resources our community needs, particularly education, to begin to address issues like child abuse.
Thank you. Just a reminder to please silence all cell phones and personal communication devices. Mr. Lopez?
On child abuse, this is a topic very close and dear to my heart. I personally have dealt with, but I've seen other people and neighbors deal with it that are friends of mine. I'll combat it in one way, and well, multiple ways, but in the first way, but it's about being there for my community and my constituents, and caring for them. I think the ultimate thing when someone's going through a child, especially in child abuse cases, the child wants someone to be there with them, to stand by their side, because they were abused, so they want someone to be by their side, to believe them, to be every step near them. So I would want to create pilot programs to go into schools and be open with students, make that relationship with students, not only with education, but also with students, to see what's going on at home, and to see if anything and everything's all right, so it doesn't hinder them from learning, and it doesn't hinder them from their adult life. And that's something that is dear and close to my heart, and child abuse will not be accepted, and is not accepted by me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gonzales. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Sotomayor.
Child abuse, there's many forms, different ways of child abuse, and a lot of them, people don't even want to talk about it. We need to be there for the families and lighten their load, lighten the single mom or the single dad. They struggle every day to feed their kids. We need to help them. Transportation is one, to lower the cost of the busing, to have 24-hour bus lines so that the parents that have to work at night can be there and not be struggling, getting home stressed because they had a hard time to get home or to get to work. We just need to be there for them and let them know all the different agencies that are out there that can help them. If they're all out there and they know they have a place to go to, they will. And I'm totally against child abuse.
Thank you.
The numbers of child abuse in District 5 are staggering. Over 30% of all child abuse cases come out of District 5, specifically in three zip codes in within the district. And so that's why in the bond, we've dedicated $1.5 million to Family Services Association towards capital improvements to help them work with other agencies and within the whole family structure to prevent child abuse. There's been $1.2 million dedicated to Child Safe for a similar similar response on the east side, and also another $1.2 million for the Battered Women's Shelter. This city has a very dirty secret of not addressing child abuse, and I believe that in this bond we're taking some steps to fund properly the nonprofits that do the best work to help with child abuse, because we know that it's not just child abuse alone, it's primarily an issue of domestic violence, and that domestic violence leads to homelessness. It's the number one cause of homelessness also is domestic violence. And
thank
so
you.
Funding Haven for Hope properly.
Ms. Cavazos?
Okay. As far as child abuse is concerned, you know, abuse is a large word. There's too many abuse. It's the main word of a hub or the umbrella of a lot of different things that can happen when somebody's being abused. There's many, many issues that come out of the word abuse. And there's many things that we can do as a people and as the community to better educate the community with prevention courses, prevention classes, anger management classes. You know, people out there, they do have anger management problems. And to be able to help them to keep themselves under control or to keep them to a point to where they're not going to hurt somebody or they're not going to abuse somebody, anger management courses is something that we need to stress.
Thank you. We're going to begin this question with Mr. Montez. UTSA students do not feel safe walking in the area around campus due to homelessness. What would you do to address this safety concern?
Thank you for this question. It's a concern that I've heard over and over again from UTSA students and folks living around Haven for Hope in these areas. I think first and foremost, we have to remember that our approach to homelessness has to continue to be compassionate. Because this is a major issue in San Antonio that we haven't quite done enough to address, we need to continue to talk about the issue but continue to be compassionate when we're addressing the homeless population in our community. But also consider the quality of life and the concern that students in this area have and faculty when they're out at night and they don't feel safe, or even when there are tourists or folks coming down to Fiesta who don't feel safe in this area. I think there definitely is a community solution, one that includes UTSA police, that includes SAPD, and that includes students and faculty having a conversation about how to address this. I think that we should approach and pursue a task force in this area to have a community solution to this issue.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez.
We shouldn't target the issue of homelessness as a crime. It's something that's happened in someone's life where they took a tough turn, or things are just not going as they planned. So what we should do is we should team up with Haven for Hope and see what resources we can implement more, and go into the courtyard to see what programs are going on in the courtyard and how we can improve programs in the courtyard for the Haven for Hope so they don't have to come out and be on our streets, and it just eliminates homeless people on the streets and panhandling. And while they're in the courtyard, they can benefit from getting training, like job-ready training, and they can be preparing resumes, and they can be getting educated. It's a simple matter, and we shouldn't be treating homelessness as a crime, because everybody does have bad days, everybody has bad weeks, and unfortunately for people that are homeless, they've just had a bad turn, but we just need to lift their spirits up and walk with them as human beings and just treat them equally and say, we're here with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Sotomayor?
I'm not an alcoholic. I don't do drugs. Yet I became homeless because of the bad choices of an individual. And being that I was at Haven, I saw all the good that they have to offer, and they have a lot of good to offer, but it's up to the individual to want to accept it, to want to get the help. At that time when I was there was, I believe, 48 different organizations at Haven for Hope that anyone could reach out at any time. You could finish your education. You could get more education there. There was a lot to do, and it was sad that I saw a lot of people that didn't want to do it. And I was very disappointed because it's like, why would you want to stay homeless? Why would you want to stay in that situation? But it's their choice. It is the people's choice that if you have the things to offer to them and they don't want to get them, we can't make them.
Thank you. Ms. Gonzales?
This has been a priority of mine for the last 4 years, and so one of the things that I was able to implement was three additional bike patrol officers, specifically in the Haven for Hope area. It includes this area as well. There are 6 law enforcement agencies just in this boundary of where we sit right now, and so having better collaboration is one way that we can do that. At VIA, in the new multimodal in the Centro Plaza, they have offered a one stop for all of the agencies to get together, because they're often restricted by their boundaries. But if they had a central location that they could go to report crimes, to report concerns in the area that were out of their jurisdiction, it would make it easier to communicate with all the other law enforcement agencies in the area. We know that a revitalization of a community makes the area safer, and we're starting to see that here in the downtown area with the multimodal improvements. We know we've got still lots of improvements in the new downtown area. There's about $23 million dedicated for Zona Cultural coming in the bond, and there's more to come from there. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Cavazos?
Okay. Regarding student safety, the students here at UTSA against homelessness, our city of San Antonio does have a problem with homelessness. I'm not going to lie. I'm going to be straightforward and honest with you. We do have a problem. But from the old location over here off of Commerce to the new location off of Martin Street, it has changed tremendously. They are in a cleaner place now. They have 2 different types of facilities, which are PC White Courtyard is where everybody gets homeless. On this side of the shelter is to be sleeping on the floor. And on the other side, that's where everybody has their own bunks, or if they're single moms, they have their own rooms. But depending on which side you go to, there's more social services on one side than there is on the other. The only service that they have on PCY Courtyard side is transportation.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez?
Yes, as asking the question, you know, as a council person, you know, you need to come up with ideas, so short-term and long-term ideas. One that I thought about is the question's being asked, of course, we must have better lighting. There's ways to improve that, to have the students feel a little bit safer as they walk around. Great, we need that. But an immediate solution, I would think, is that UTSA, maybe we can create some type of van ride share with several different pickup points, so the student can get on, show their student ID, and they can get to different travel points safely. Because, you know, we have the homeless or the aggressive homeless situation going on. Well, let's make sure it's a short-term fix, but it's a solution. And later, for long-term, let's discuss it with VIA, and maybe we can work some coordinated system out. Because the students are continuing. They got to go to school. They got to get home. But let's make some safety points. And that's the way I would go, a rideshare program. Some type of van. You show your ID card. Maybe it's your resident RA driving around. But it's we want to make them feel safe, and we have to give them that safe opportunity. That's my quick answer.
Thank you. We're going to start this next question with Mr. Lopez. Do you want, or what is your position on San Antonio being a sanctuary city?
My view on San Antonio being a sanctuary city is, I'm not going to lie, we're a city that is dominated by Hispanic, by the Hispanic culture, and by a lot of Mexican-American native people, and a lot of Mexican people that aren't here legally. But America is a land of opportunity. It is a land where people come to escape whatever their homeland is not doing, and for them to be safe. In this last election with our president, we saw that our race and our culture is under attack. and we need to have a voice and implement that voice, to not be afraid and to show that we the people are in charge. We the people have the right to say what's going on in our city government and our national government, and it's we the people that can make the change. As San Antonio being a sanctuary city, it happens. We're here for everybody else, and this is our culture. This is what makes San Antonio San Antonio, is the culture that we have here. Thank you.
Ms. Sotomayor?
We're studying that right now, and as soon as our committee gets more educated on that, we're going to take care of that.
Thank you. Ms. Gonzales?
I led the charge for the city council to take the initiative to become a sanctuary city last year. I was able to get five of my council members to support San Antonio become a sanctuary city. It went to the governance committee, and from there, Chief McManus made some commitments that law enforcement officers would not be immigration officers, and also a commitment to have a committee to address this issue. This climate has changed significantly since Donald Trump became the president. I still believe that we have to protect immigrants, especially the most vulnerable of immigrants. I myself am the daughter of an immigrant from Mexico who came here just like everybody else looking for work and looking for opportunity. We know that the members of the students, the DACAs in particular, have been fighting very hard on this issue. The climate for sanctuary cities has changed so drastically. I don't know what that would look like in today's climate, but I feel very strongly that we could have become a sanctuary city, and I would continue to support our efforts
Thank
to
you.
Do that.
Ms. Cavazos.
Okay. As far as the city, I still have questions regarding sanctuary city. So I'm for it, and then I'm against it. You know, there's a lot of different opinions. There's too many issues within the bill or the sanctuary city portion of the whole thing that it's really kind of hard. We have so many people coming from Mexico, which is the massive country that we have so many immigrants coming from or migrants coming from. They don't have a job, or they're trying to come over here so they can get themselves a better job. And they can't get the job over there for some reason or another. Maybe they don't have enough work, maybe they don't have enough, whatever it is that they don't have. I know their cost of living is a lot less than what our cost of living is over here, but we do make a lot more money over here. So it would make it that much more easier for them to have money by working on this side and becoming educated, and then having that dollar amount or that capita and taking it with them back home so they can be that sociologist, so they can be that psychologist and help their country.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez. I'm sorry, Yañez. Mr. Yañez. Yes. What is your position on San Antonio being a sanctuary city?
Right. My position is, my answer to that is no. I don't think we are a sanctuary city. I think we are beyond that. I think San Antonio has led the way for the nation. We have been a very understanding, complementary city. You know, our interracial marriages, our understanding of how San Antonio has become, we're beyond that. We should be the leader in regarding discussion of immigration. I think we should define ourselves more as like Habitat for Humanity. I think we should call ourselves a shelter city, because a sanctuary city is just a blanket for everyone. That's also including people who have criminal offenses. You know, I don't want to include that. I want to look out for the folks that want to build a home and build a job for their family. That's why I'm thinking a shelter city. So the way to go is a sanctuary city is not the way. But I think because the city of San Antonio Police Department and the Sheriff's Office, they're not immigration officers, they're not enforcing it. We have ICE to do that, and the new administration will be working on that with the federal government. But I think as San Antonio, we should be our advocacy that we provide shelter. You can get a job, get work, and you don't have a garbage unless you get a ticket and you pay your fee. And unless it converts to a warrant, you're okay.
That's Thank you. Mr. Montez.
Thank you. This is another issue of compassion for me, and I think that the city of San Antonio should be a sanctuary city. But it's going to take more than just one city council person to stand up to the Trump administration and say that we are backing immigrants coming into this country because of the push-pull factors that force them to leave their country. And many of the folks that I meet that are undocumented truly love their country, whether they're coming from Central America or they're coming from Mexico. They don't necessarily want to leave their homes, but they are forced out because of the war and the gang violence that they are facing in the southern part of our world with drugs. So I agree that San Antonio should be a sanctuary city. We should have some more compassion, but we need our city officials, our state legislature, our governors, and all leaders across America to stand up with San Antonio and be that model that we need to show that compassion to immigrants coming from Central America and Mexico.
Thank you. We're going to start this question with Ms. Sotomayor. Many seniors in San Antonio, the seventh largest city in the U.S., need food and transportation. What would you do to change that?
Have you sent some buses that don't charge them because they're doing really good right now? And the seniors have a hard time getting to the places because if they live in a home or in a senior citizen's place of living, they don't always provide that. They don't provide a bus or taxi for them to go. They have to pay that for on their own, and they are already living on a budget. So they've made it to be seniors. They're blessed. So why can't we bless them back and let them ride for free? Let them take a taxi and not charge them. If they take them to the doctor, Medicaid covers it. Well, wouldn't it be less if the bus or they send a via trans to take them to do whatever it is they needed to do or wanted to do? Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gonzales.
Our senior centers provide wonderful access for food and for entertainment for our seniors. I'm very proud of our Normal Senior Center and our District 5 Senior Center. Not only do they provide meals, but they provide companionship, which is one of the great problems that we have for some of our seniors is just loneliness. I'm trying to get a pilot program where transportation network companies like Uber and Lyft provide services to seniors, to some of our senior centers and to other facilities around the city. They're doing that in other cities. I was recently in Chicago on behalf of the city talking about our Vision Zero program, which is a different program. But Uber and Lyft are providing this kind of service in Chicago in particular, chartering buses and taking seniors to events and to facilities that the city sponsors. So I think this might be a quick solution to what is a transportation problem citywide. We know that we need greater investment in public transit, but this is a pilot.
Thank you, Ms. Gonzales. Ms. Cavazos?
Public transportation for the elderly or the disabled. Right now, I think VIA has got a pretty good thing going on. We have many people in the district or throughout the city of San Antonio that are disabled and that need that extra help. They have what's called CNAs, medical assistants that are there that can help them. So if we can find a way to better come up with a transportation plan to make sure that they get here to their doctor's visits. Like I said, VIA does have a pretty good program that they have for the disabled and the elderly. But the institutions that have these elderly, they need to make sure that they have some type of transportation to take them to and from.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez?
Right. In regards to food and transportation needs for the seniors, well, if there's a constituent in my district, then I want to help their needs. If there's a problem that they're shut in, they're not getting the right support, then I want to help the constituent as best as I can. I think in regards to, you know, that's how you can examine if they have needs for food. You have to figure out what their problems are. They might have multi-needs, even cutting their breasts. We have to identify what their issues are and then meet them halfway or help them all the way. in regards to transportation. I guess I would work with VIA and figure out examine the current solution that's being done for the seniors, maybe lower the rates a little bit, because I do believe the seniors, and it's also if they're military veterans, they should get a discount. They look out for us. The seniors have looked out for us. They've paid their due, and it's also a military veterans. You know, they're protecting our borders and our shoreline, and they're, you know, they're across the world, so we got to give incentives about them. So I would like to see something like that to reduce the fares, to give them the same, to budget for those types of groups. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Montez?
Is Canopy part of the corporate community, and if we can get them and collaborate with them, that can be a real solution to some of our seniors finding everything they need in a one-stop shop where they live.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez?
I believe the issue comes back on City Council. Each district has a representative that is elected, and like I've mentioned before, as a city councilman, you are my boss. You are who I want to impress. You are who I want to do anything for. So I think it all starts within our office as well. A senior citizen needs to have their grass cut. We need to be active and put a team out there, even if we have to go do it ourselves. We need to be active in the community, and we need to show that we care for our senior citizens. And as for buses, we need to fight for the senior citizens to see if we can get their own bus stops where it's closer to their house and more safer to get out. Or we get their own bus, not via trans, but not the via bus, those ones for disabilities and ones for the general population, but we get a bus just dedicated for senior citizens 65 and up that can be at discounted rates or possibly for free, and we can just work like that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to be able to get at least two more questions in before we go to the closing statements. So I'd like to ask you to please hold your applause until the end so that we can get at least two and possibly more questions in. And Ms. Gonzales, we're back to you to start with this one. How could you help us make Las Palmas Library more visible?
In the bond, we also have an additional $1.7 million dedicated for Las Palmas Library. And the space around Las Palmas has room for lots of creativity. There's great open spaces. There's a park next door. It's also connected right to the YWCA, the Women's Center. And so there's great synergy there already happening right around the Las Palmas Library. I myself am a big supporter of the library and take my children very often for story time and bilingual story time for arts and crafts there. So we have the bones for a great center there. Hopefully that investment will help not just with the facade improvements, but will also help with the technology. We know that Las Palmas needs some updating, as many of our buildings do. It's quite old, but the foundation of it is really great. It has a beautiful architectural design, and it's got a great open spaces, so just capitalizing on what already exists is something that I'm very supportive of, and I showed that support by moving some of our funding into the library in this upcoming
bond.
Thank
you. Ms. Cavazos?
The Las Palmas Library, it's in the area that I reside at right now. It's a nice library. It's a little small. On the right-hand side, when you go into the library, we have tons of businesses or tons of offices that if we take those out, it would be a nicer location. It would be a larger library, and we would not have to keep our students or the children from the community not being able to use that portion. So they would be in a larger library, and it would be a lot easier. But other than that, I think if we take out those, it would be a nicer library and probably bring in more services, more social services, and more educational services and programs for the ones who don't have a GED yet.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez?
What I think I'd like to do is I would like to discuss it with the constituents in the area for Las Palmas, because it is a small library. Why not consider relocating or building a brand new library near Emily Elmendorf Park, near our Lake of the Lake, so that way the folks can have a nice library and view the lake. That might be a new step, because we haven't had a new library in the area for a long, long, long time. And I think it's time that we invest some money in our future, and I think that might be the way to go. But I would discuss it with the constituents with an idea and create a design team to say, hey, let's do something new, because I think the one would be great. Investment, money spent investment at Elmendorf Park. Our Lady of the Lake is booming, and I think a nice public library so people can go and enjoy the lake and study and have that view, I think that would be great. So why not develop that for our west side?
Thank you. Ms. Montez.
Thank you. I think there's two different solutions here. I think there's a physical solution, right? Investing in the facade and the presence and the area surrounding Las Palmas and improving that and making sure that there are monies allocated for those improvements. But I also think that there is an activity-based solution, and that is ensuring that there are activities at the library that are attracting youth and families into the library. One of the things I'd like to see more in our community is more attention to STEM. And I think we should get the tech community involved. Having a background myself, having worked in people operations, one of the things I think we're missing in our community is hackathons, code jams, opportunities like that for our kids to learn coding and software development. And I think those are the jobs and the training of the future. And I think that kids, even in elementary schools now who are learning it formally, would appreciate having those types of functions and opportunities at our libraries. So a more activity-driven solution to attract folks to Las Palmas, for instance, which is a library that I attended growing up, I think are part of those solutions.
Thank you. Mr. Montez?
Las Palmas Library. I love Las Palmas Library because when I would get out of school and my mother was on the other side of town, she would be like, walk to Las Palmas. My school is right next to there, so I'd always remember walking to Las Palmas Library and struggling to find a table. And because Las Palmas is a very popular place where a lot of children and a lot of parents and children like to go after school and cool down, because it's really hot outside after school. And they like to go there and just study and be there with their family, get homework done, and stay on that educational path. Las Palmas, we could use a bigger library and a more updated library, bringing new computers, faster internet and Wi-Fi, better printing, and bringing more services. Like we should have book clubs, more book clubs, more art clubs. Embrace the culture, embrace the art. And by art, it's very a wide variety of art. We can do sculpting, we can do painting. Art is such a beautiful thing that that Las Palmas is known for, with all the arts that
Thank
is
you.
Doing there. Thank you.
Ms. Sotomayor.
It is a nice library, but I think if you would ask the neighborhood around there, they would want a bigger one and with more computers. And because of the hours that the parents work, some get out a little later. Maybe if they extended the hours so that all the kids can have access to it. In that area, not too many of the families can afford a computer. They can't afford the gaming that they have in the libraries. And that would be nice to add that to there. That way all the kids can have fun. They can all go and get educated, because all the games that are there, they're pretty educational, what that are at other libraries. And I'd like to see that there at Las Palmas.
Thank you. I'm going to start this with Ms. Cavazos. Can you speak to your vision for our youth in regard to civic engagement and higher educational opportunities?
I'm sorry, what was the question again?
Can you speak to your vision for our youth in regard to civic engagement and higher educational opportunities?
Okay. What it is that I'm looking for, or what I have planned so far for the constituent body, District 5, is to bring in more educational services to keep our San Antonio Independent School Districts, as well as the Edgewood Independent School District, to a point to where they will have the services that they need after school care, which will bring more computers into those classrooms, which will keep them to the point to where they're going to have fun in the challenge program, the after school challenge program. That'll keep them busy. It will keep them up to date with their schoolwork, with their homework, with everything that they have going on right now anyway. But when it comes to other things going on, like curricular activities, extracurricular activities, they'll be able to go out into the community, not into the community, but out to the games. And then those that don't want to go to the game, they don't have to go to the game. They can just stay there.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez?
Yes. For civic engagement, I think it's important that somehow we must make a connection with the school or the school board. I would say I'd like to talk to the teachers and let them know that, hey, if any student in high school goes and get a San Antonio Public Library card, you know, give them a little bump on their grade from a B to an A. Let them know that they're appreciated, but we also have to have the numbers for our statistics. I think also one of the things that I see is that sometimes the students are not getting the message, and between the years of 18 to 25, they are not aware that they should register, males register for Selective Service. Somehow there's a disengagement occurring, and if you drop out of high school, then you're really not getting the message. So I would give the chance for the San Antonio Public Library, once these students get their library card, maybe fashion a new card for them, to let them know that they're important and we need them in the city of San Antonio. There is a future for them, and we must consider to say, hey, these are the different jobs that we need, and please pick one because we need your guidance. Whatever the job is, put the statistics and let them pick one. Say, I wish to be an accountant, I wish to be a doctor. Let them make a decision and let them know that we need them. Somehow bridge that connection.
Thank you. Mr. Montez?
Thank you. One of the things our campaign has talked about over and over again is building more solid, collaborative, and innovative relationships with our school districts. I think more often than not, there's been sort of a taboo for city officials to talk about education and for education officials to talk about city issues. And I think we need to break that taboo and really begin to form closer bonds with our school district officials to create policies that are innovative and creative. But the other thing I want to talk about is, you know, in our community, we also need to make sure to be providing assistance to folks who want to go to college, and that those types of assistance are reflected in the policies that universities create, that the city creates. For instance, I know the students here at UTSA are fighting for childcare. The childcare initiative here at UTSA has become a very big conversation. And I think that if we are going to prove to the youth and young people that we want them to be educated, it needs to start being reflected in the policies that we implement to help them move forward with higher education.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez?
My vision for youth in the community is I see youth as the leaders of tomorrow. The youth are going to be the men and women who are going to lead the generation and lead the community in the aspects of what's going on tomorrow. So what we need to do is we need to encourage education. We can't be afraid to talk about it in city forums or in city hall, and we need to speak up on education just to show that we do care, and education is important. Education is something that's helped me personally, and I've seen the two paths of a public education and an education of something where a teacher is more interacted with you. I've recently graduated 2 years ago from high school, and the education that was instilled has prompted me to run for city council because I see that there is a need and that there is an outcry in the West Side for more education, and we need to provide college assistance for more people, and thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Sotomayor?
Our kids are our future, and if we don't discipline them, if we don't raise them right, they're not going to get it right. We need to install God in them. I work with teenagers, and a lot of them struggle because their parents are struggling, and they feel the tension of their parents' struggle, and that shouldn't be happening. So we need to be there for the kids, for their family, so that they can be well educated, because we should not be afraid of a 15-year-old or a 13-year-old, and it starts at home. So if we raise them right and we teach them God and have God put back in the school, we wouldn't be having all these problems.
Amen. Thank you. Mr. Gonzales.
So District 5 has three universities, I'm counting St. Mary's because it's just across the border, and one community college in our district. Now, a lot of people don't know that. We have the most universities, we have the most parks, we have the most libraries, right here in District 5, yet we have less than 3% college attainment in the district. And so that's a very sad disconnect in the amount of educational opportunities there are in the district and the people who are taking advantage of them. So the civic engagement has to go both ways. We need to encourage our youth and our community to take advantage of the opportunities that exist. But we also need for the universities to do a better job of reaching out to the community as well. Because I know at Our Lady of the Lake, and I think here at UTSA, also a very, very small percentage, it could be something like also in the 3% range, students are from District 5 who attend the schools. And I did a little poll as I went walking around introducing myself, and I know many of y'all are students here, and I think only one of you lives in the district.
Thank you. Ms. Cavazos, I'm sorry. Oh, I started with you, okay. I've moved on then. We're starting with Mr. Yañez for our final question. What do you plan to do to improve the parks and open spaces within the district?
I guess the best way is to increase the area for pedestrian travel, perhaps also with bike lanes. People want to walk, but they also must have the pedestrian lanes accompanied with a bike lane. Make it more inclusive so that way they can get around the entire park a little bit faster from end to end. Also, you just have to examine the lighting and make sure that, you know, some folks want to jog or ride their bikes at night. Have it set up that the lighting is still bright up to maybe 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and then, you know, value for their safety. Those are the key ideas I have for parks. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think one of the things we need to focus on is making our green spaces more inviting to people, particularly in District 5. You go to parks across our community that have only porta potties and fountains that don't work. So investing in basic amenities in our park is important. But I also want to talk about, you know, some of the initiatives going around, on across the country, particularly in Baltimore. You take a look at both Baltimore and what they've done with their green spaces is they've begun to allow the community to adopt, for instance, vacant lots. That haven't been utilized, that are underutilized, that are in despair, that have issues with dumping, and allow the community to take, to be empowered and take over those vacant spaces and begin to, you know, add green greenery, flower beds, benches for folks to sit on as they're walking in the community. I think, and you may have heard this theme in a lot that I'm saying, is that there's a community solution to these green spaces. If we find over and over again that the city isn't quite allocating the number of monies needed for these spaces, in the bond that we have coming up, District 5 was only allocated $1 million for 5 parks. That tells you something.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez.
Parks and Recreation. I love going to parks, and I like going to parks at night. I like walking around at night just to walk around, blow some steam off of a tough day. But I do see that and do know that parks and District 5 do need better lighting. And we'll fight for better lighting and for more resources to get that lighting. And what we also need to do is feel safe. Feel safe at the parks at night for the people that want to go after work, after a long day, to blow stress off and just feel safe. And for the greenery, we should incorporate community gardens within our parks. What better way for a community garden than to be at a park? A park is somewhere where families get together, have fun, barbecues, parties, and we can see the community garden and even use from the community garden. I think that would be a very good way to get people to the park and a very healthy way to also bring in the health aspects of the park. And we can run, play basketball, and then look at the nutrition side. Oh, we're growing this. And we can also eat this, and it's healthy. Thank you.
Thank you.
We found out the hard way that Elmendorf Park only has 3 barbecue pits. We love to barbecue. Who doesn't love to go to the park and barbecue? And with 3 barbecue pits in that whole area, that they need to put some more barbecue pits out there with tables. Because it's a beautiful place. The little lake there, it's beautiful. It's just lacking that and some more restrooms. So we need to have a lot of good lighting for the parks, for sure. But also make sure there's enough barbecue pits.
Thank you. Ms. Gonzales?
As I mentioned, District 5 has more parks than any other in the district. And we can connect all the way from Aldette at the Park to the far west side, all along our Westside Creeks to Elmendorf, to, I'm sorry, to from from Aleta Park to Rosedale to Elmendorf to Gaciano to Vidaudi there, Benavides and Vidaudi, all the way through to the south side. It connects all the way to the end of Espada Creek. There is almost no other place in the entire country that has a linear park like this one. Now, our parks need some updating, and I think Elmendorf Park is a wonderful example of how we can transform a park when we're willing to invest in them. Since I've been on the council, I've invested an additional $2 million in our parks just through our regular budget. There's an additional $4 million in parks in the bond, and so we're looking forward to continuing that wonderful tradition of family spending time in our parks. And the idea that you can connect from one to the other is something really, really unique to San Antonio, and it's one of the things I'm most proud of.
Thank you. Ms. Cavazos?
Landscaping. Landscaping is something that I want to see done in our local parks. And depending on which park we're speaking about, you know, some of the parks really don't need anything. Some do have adequate barbecue pits, or they have a running walk for people to run or ride their bikes or whatever. There are some parks that don't have toilets. They don't have water fountains or bike racks or anything like that. But what I'm looking for in some of the parks is something that's going to be nice, something that's going to look good, something that anybody can go and then just walk around and have a nice scenery or be able to see something that's going to be calming. You know, like them huge, big old boulder rocks or whatever, them large ones, man-made ponds and, you know, something like that. But then yet, at the same time, that's what y'all are going to have to decide on. Y'all, as a constituent body, are going to have to come together and figure out exactly what it is that you want for those parks.
Thank you. I believe I saw Mr. Ponce, Gerard Ponce, who's also a mayoral candidate, came in. And did I miss any other mayoral candidates? Okay. The question on civic engagement, if I may, one of the things that young people and really all of us here can do to be engaged in the process is to vote. The last day to register to vote for the municipal elections is Thursday, April 6th. The city council and mayoral elections impact your life on a day-to-day basis more than the presidential elections do. And yet last year, only 12% of registered voters voted in the, not last year, 2 years ago, in the municipal elections. So let's have a personal goal here tonight that we at least double that for this go-around. So please go and vote. We're going to give the candidates their final one-minute closing statement, a question that we didn't get a chance to ask, but you may want to incorporate in your final statement is, what from your life experience inspired you to run for office?
Why are you convinced to do this work?
Why are you convinced? Okay. Why are you convinced to do this work? So if you want to include that, we are going to close in the opposite way that we opened, so we'll start with Ms. Sotomayor.
I've been working for several organizations, and I've been to many community meetings and many city meetings, and I see the lack of attention that they get. They'll say, yes, you'll get that, and 2 years can go by and nothing's happened. And I'm not afraid to go out there and combat that. I want to show the people that I'm there for you. If you ask me for something, I'm going to do my best to do it for you, to get things done, to accomplish things. I've had a hard time in my life, and I fought for my family, and I got justice, and that's what I plan to do now, to fight for you and to be there and let you know I'm not just here so that you can talk. I'm listening to you. I'm paying attention to you. And I'll give it the best I have. And of course, being a Christian, I'm going to always put God first.
Thank you. Mr. Lopez?
I want to thank the League of Women Voters of San Antonio for having us here, and also for UTSA for lending us the space. Something that's made me run, I haven't been in the realms of politics or in the city council or or in anything for too long. On my senior year of high school, I really became interested in the city council and the way how our government works at a city level and at a national level. And we need to start somewhere. I see that there is a need for change, and I see that there is a cry within my district that wants the change, that wants the attention that the city lacks from a year-to-year election cycle to election cycle and day-to-day cycle. It's something that we need to get together. We need to get to City Hall together and say, we need to put attention here. There is a lack of education in District 5. There's a lack of communication in District 5. And us together, as people, as community members, and as residents of San Antonio and community members in District 5, need to all go together, and we need to all go to City Council and say, we need the help.
Mr. Montez?
Thank you. I want to invite all of you to visit our website, multis5.com, and you can find a lot of information about me and my background. And I think it's important to be able to tell people that. But I also want to make sure that I issue an invitation to all of you from UTSA to come to District 5 and participate and expose our young people to academia. I think that this community here at UTSA can be more involved with our kids playing sports, can be more involved in our schools, in our community centers. So if you're a student here at UTSA, I'd like to invite you to come into District 5 and participate in the lives of our youth and our community, because it's important. I am proud to have a UTSA graduate student as my campaign manager, running the day in and day out hard work that's required to run a campaign. So I know and I see how hard UTSA students work. You guys have some of the best work ethic I have ever seen. And I want that to be a part of the strength that we have of having UTSA in this community of District 5. Let's build on that success, because I know the solutions are found in you. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Yañez?
I'm a product of SAIC School District. I am a graduate of Burbank High School. I think in regards to change, I think one person can make a change. In any situation, they can recognize the problem and become the leader to make that change for everyone. But there must be the lightning rod, so I'm ready to do that. And you asked about, why are we running historically? I think about different events that I've seen on TV. And I've always wanted to be an attorney. I was back to that civic engagement idea, I think, for the library card. If you were to ask me, while I was in high school, I would say, I want to be an attorney. Maybe that we can put on the library card. What is it that you want to be? And everyone can recognize it and support it. As you foster these ideas, you want encouragement. So being an attorney, it was always on my mind, always a subject, always an interest growing up. But I never voiced it to many people. But it was not until I got to college and reinforced with other students, say, hey, I'm going to be an attorney. And they had it automatically. I had to develop mine. I wish to encourage others to be recognized for their goals, and also want to know that, hey, other people can achieve their dreams. I respectfully ask for your vote.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Cavazos.
My name is Cynthia T. Cavazos, and I'm a candidate for City Council District 5. What made me become a candidate, or what inspired me to run for office, was my past. I was a homeless person. I lived homeless at the SAM Ministries that's right here off of Commerce. And then from there, I transferred to Haven for Hope. I was a single mother of 5 children, still am. and they're beautiful children. And now I have 6 or 7, maybe 8. 12 grandkids. you have a certain amount of number of grandchildren, and sometimes it feels like you have more than what you already have. But I have noticed with the upbringing of my grandchildren, every once in a while when I go and see them, that they're different. My children, as they were growing up, they were different. Everybody has different attitudes. They have different opinions. And if we, again, come to figure what it is our constituent body needs, is education and anger management.
Thank you.
I'm Shirley Gonzales. I'm the councilwoman for District 5, running for re-election for my third term on City Council. I originally got to run for City Council because I was having so much trouble growing my small business. And I wanted one of my major platforms to be helping small businesses in the community. But what I came to learn was that there were so many needs in District 5. And we've addressed some of them today: issues with child abuse, issues with education, homelessness, lack of quality housing, many of the things that we all hear about very often in District 5, high crime rates, drug addiction, all these things really were the biggest priority for our district. Things like just basic infrastructure, which we still desperately need and that I continue to advocate for. Improved lighting in the area. The things, the basic things that the people really expected of their council member, I have taken those on in my first two terms. I look forward to continuing to serve you these next 2 years. My commitment hasn't wavered. Every day I look forward to serving you, and I hope to continue to do that for another 2 years.
As Ms. Gonzales said, we have answered a lot of questions on a broad range of topics. You have great questions. Unfortunately, these we did not have time to ask, but I'm sure that, I feel certain that the candidates would be willing to stick around for a few minutes and talk with you. That does conclude our candidate forum for this evening. Please join me in thanking the candidates for coming here to be with us.